Our next speaker is someone I first chatted with in one of those interviews on the Forward 50 channel. He's been building, along with a few people we spoke with last year, ways to make democracy more resilient. Obviously, we've heard earlier on from Alexa Rad about the vulnerabilities of an open society being that it's attackable by our adversaries who would use disinformation to do us harm. But how do we understand what's true, what's false, and how to have better conversations? Because democracy is this balance between the will of the many and the cacophony of the crowd, and then the rights of the individual. Finding a balance between those two things is harder than ever in today's polarized world. And Nick Adams is working to fix that, creating tools that use the power of crowds to highlight the truth and listen at scale. So please welcome for our final talk this afternoon on Channel One, the founder and chief scientist of Goodly Labs, Nick Adams. Hello, Nick.
Hello. Am I coming through?
Yeah, you look great. Are you in, you're in Berkeley, right?
I'm in Berkeley. Yeah. Wonderful. Thank you. Thank you so much for having me, Alistair, and everyone out there listening.
I'm just thrilled we were able to get you. Last year we talked, but we didn't have you in the lineup. And I think some of the things you had to say were so important that I'm really glad we're going to give you proper airtime here. And so you've got about 40 minutes to give a talk here, and then you can hop over to the Q&A for people who want to talk to you one-on-one. That's kind of the Forward 50 equivalent of rushing the stage. So if you have questions for Nick, and at the end of this, we'll remind you how to get into the Q&A session. You can continue the conversation there, but have fun, Nick.
Great. Thank you so much. This is a very fresh talk, hot off the presses. So I'm excited to be with you all here today. The first thing I want to do is, are my slides working? There they go. I just want to acknowledge that I'm speaking to you from the San Francisco Bay Area of California, and I'm here today only because of the losses and sufferings of lots of people, the Ohlone tribe in particular, but also many people in the United States who built the infrastructure that made this whole country possible. So this acknowledgement is just a small thing. There's a lot more we need to do, but I wanted to make that acknowledgement to begin. I'm really excited today to talk to you about listening at scale and how we can move from this kind of cacophony that we're all experiencing across democratic republics into a more reflexive and orderly society that hopefully makes a lot more sense. In the spirit of the older film, Dr. Strangelove, I also have an alternative title, which is How I Learned to Stop Worrying and Love Social Technology. And part one here, I'm gonna scare you a little bit. Are democracies being left behind? So once upon a time, my life was on a course that was setting me up to be in the audience for this sort of talk, to be a government official fighting the good fight like many of you. I dreamed of helping the kinds of people I've connected with throughout a life that began in near poverty. Humble but intelligent people with far more potential than they can realize, without access to better resources and opportunities and pathways for effective cooperation. I really revered America's founders. I believed in the American dream. And even though I didn't come from a great family, people told me, especially with the identity characteristics you can readily perceive, that I could be anything I wanted to be. After studying political science in university, I worked on and ran successful electoral campaigns, and I was pretty good at it. I could rouse a crowd, geek out with policy wonks, and organize volunteers to get out the vote. But I wasn't quite ready to become a contender for office. I felt a responsibility to first learn all I could about how society really works. So I came to Berkeley to the world's best sociology department to get a PhD. And there I learned perhaps too much, at least too much to continue pursuing a career as a politician. Sociology taught me that throughout history, there have been forces far more powerful than any individual that have been driving the most impactful changes to society. Of course, we can look at almost any revolutionary flashpoint in history and find somebody at the front of a crowd. But when we look deeper underneath those moments and trace a causal chain backward in time, the same pattern emerges. The real change occurred months, years, or decades earlier, and the exciting revolutionary episode was merely the fruit of a larger causal tree. Sometimes these causal trees are mostly cultural. The worldly asceticism of the Calvinists set a standard of individual productivity that over time, everyone living in Western civilization had to adopt if they wanted to remain housed and fed and socially accepted. More often, the real change occurs through technology. The invention of factories changed the economics of European labor and commerce, eventually making feudal economics obsolete along with its aristocratic politics. By this more sociological account of history, all the resulting movements for democracy we so often lionize in our national origin stories were entirely overdetermined. They would have happened one way or another, even if history's main characters never existed. So we didn't need Jefferson in particular, nor Robespierre, to have democratic revolutions in America and across Europe. I do not say this to insult those of you who work in government or convince you that you're irrelevant. Chaos theory actually teaches us that small changes on the surface of a wave can sometimes create cascading effects that change the force and shape of the wave itself. But we all must understand the historical waves we are surfing, both to stay atop them and to recognize when our actions might beneficially shift their speed or direction. So to take stock of our moment in history, let us think for a moment about China and its history. It's certainly the largest nation in the world, and depending on interpretations, it's the longest surviving large-scale civilization. Or we can also think about Islam for a moment. It's the world's second largest religion, influencing the daily lives of over 1 billion people. Now, we can debate whether these communities are constituted mostly by culture or by technology, but the lines between these concepts blur rather quickly when we observe how much of our realities are constructed by social norms, customs, and policies that rely on technology. For instance, the daily calls to prayer in Islam were first made through word of mouth and then through horns, then through speakers spilling out their herald into the streets. And now there are actually several apps that adherents can download to their mobile devices. This blend of culture and technology is apparent in governments as well. Whether via paper forms or digital transactions, government bureaucracies rely on technologies and can even be credibly described as technologies themselves, technologies for human coordination. Regardless of how we distinguish culture and technology, China and Islam both represent massive human accomplishments. Over 1 billion people every day patterning their lives around customs, laws, norms, and practices that have been hundreds or thousands of years in the making. Now, let's think about Facebook, or now it's called Meta. How many lives are shaped by these cultural technologies, Facebook and WhatsApp and Instagram? The answer is billions. And how long did it take them to bring so many people into their sphere of influence? Was it millennia, like China? Many centuries, like Islam? It was 15 years. And even on this graph here, you'll notice that the last segment of the x-axis really takes 15 years, where the others took 500. And you can already see that huge line pointing straight up for Facebook. So I really hope everyone will drink this in a bit. Over 2 billion people are using Facebook products, and it all happened in over a decade. Maybe it causes some of you who live for impacting the world to feel a little insecure about your career choices. I promise I'm a nice guy. Maybe you feel a shiver of awe about these powerful technological historical forces that you don't control. But here's a simple fact about our time. Governments' power to influence, understand, engage with, and inspire their populations is fading, particularly relative to technology. And this trend is inexorable unless the people watching this talk learn to harness the power of social technologies. Now, I promise we'll end this talk on a happier note and hold time for a more hopeful discussion. But for now, let's take a look at some evidence that government's irrelevance is on the rise. I feel really bad saying this to this audience. Well, we have Brexit and we have Tea Party populism. For instance, all of these different movements represent a rejection of representative democracy. People are losing trust in their elites. Certainly the elites of the other political parties, and probably all of them. And it's not just governments. Media, universities, religious authorities, public health agencies, banks, criminal justice systems, the police, schools, intelligence agencies, philanthropy. It's really across the board. Trust in major social institutions rates lower than ever throughout the Western world and beyond. Some of this loss of legitimacy is self-inflicted, but it's all happening in a broader context. Think for a moment about the ways that constituents typically interface with government. And actually, for some audience participation, maybe you'll go ahead and write your answer in the chat. Think about how you interface with government and how other people interface with government. This is actually really timely for me because on my way over here to deliver the talk, I got a parking ticket. And that's how a lot of people experience government. It's parking tickets. It's getting pulled over by the police and the fear of that. It's paying fines. It's paying taxes. Repeated cycles of campaigners who overpromise and elected officials who underdeliver. Reading about scandals in the news. Some of this is unavoidable by our current models of government, but much of it is quite negative. And it seems even worse to people when we look at it in a broader context. The international economy is making goods and services cheaper and easier. The necessary tools of business, email, word processing, spreadsheets, calendars, video conferencing, they're now largely free, thanks to Google. Food delivery, transportation, vacation rentals, dating, entertainment, and many more human desirables are only a click away. So while everything else in people's lives has become more efficient and convenient, representative democracies have not. They're still running on bureaucratic technology created in the 1800s. And you know, we can even look at the space race. In the 1960s and 70s, nation states sprinted from Earth in an attempt to test whether it was better to run a national economy in a centralized way, providing for people's needs, or in a decentralized way, providing for their wants. The false dilemma for the ages. Now those nation states are all but irrelevant beyond Earth's atmosphere, and the space race is being run by a few billionaires. This is really troubling, but the withering impotence of government is even more obvious when we regard the case of Facebook. Of course, it's more than a little embarrassing that Facebook commands more daily attention and influence than governments that have existed 20 times longer and hold credible monopolies on the legitimized use of force. But it's even worse. Revelations of whistleblowers demonstrate that Facebook has profited handsomely from activities on its platform that sow chaos and division among the constituencies of democratic republics, your people. And they know it. Rather than fix these problems, Facebook has publicly asked for governments to fix them via regulation, a curious strategy that so far has resulted in precious little change to their profitable role, hosting the world's largest and quite unruly public forums. So what is on the horizon for the relationship between communications technologies and Westphalian representative democracies? It may help to approach the question like an engineer seeking to integrate two technologies. Today's mass communications technologies are designed for many-to-many interaction, thanks to communications infrastructure that easily carries messages around the world in mere seconds. When people can instantly share their expressions with many people and instantly hear from many people, ideas spread farther and faster than any of our nation's founders would ever have imagined. Their communications technologies were so different because basic technology was so rustic. When the fastest way to reliably send a message relies on horses or pigeons, real deliberation about policy must happen face to face. So sending representatives from across the land is a very sensible approach. But if the intrepid and innovative founders of so many democratic countries were designing governments today, would they rely on beast-based communication? A few years ago, we might have dismissed this rhetorical question as cute, but the future is clarifying before our eyes, and the people building it have no more reverence for our founders' sacred governance architectures than a software engineer has for someone else's outdated buggy code. The relevance of democratic governments is being challenged from above, below, within, and without. And so far, they have hardly responded, especially here in the United States. Okay, so I hope the gravity of this historical moment is sinking in, but I'm not here only to scare you. Soon I'll show you some directions forward to ensure the next 50 years are safe for democracy. But I would first like to recommend that we lean into the incipient feeling of panic here. I think we should have a bit of a good old-fashioned freakout. There is ample reason. China is developing social reputation technology that is highly consequential for Chinese livelihoods. Big tech is handing to authoritarians communications technologies that are 100x more powerful than those used by Goebbels. And within our borders, those same tech companies' products are amplifying discord, chaos, and outrageous misinformation that is getting people killed, all while gutting the revenue streams of the fourth estate, which is now increasingly caught up in the narrative wars that generate the clicks they need to operate along with the crippling polarization. So I'm gonna ask for some audience participation here. I'm a big believer and the idea that we cannot avoid our emotions. We have to feel them. We have to work through them. I'm noticing that my lighting is terrible. Let me just take care of that in a second. Okay, now I don't have, well, it's still pretty bad. okay, better. So, let's see, where was I? I'm a big believer in the idea that we cannot avoid our emotions. We kind of have to feel them and work through them and understand the thoughts that support them and ideally find a way to reframe those thoughts so our destructive, ruminating anxieties can become more constructive worries that actually propel us into effective action. The first step in that process is to really feel the emotion. So I'm going to read through these troubling dynamics again. And what I love is for each of you to show me and show each other which is most concerning to you. And we're going to do that a little more dramatically than by a mere showing of hands. We're going to get into our bodies and really feel the freak out. We're going to face it and express it and let it dissipate so we can begin reframing it into something healthier and more productive. I actually have some experience constructively freaking out. So let me offer you some pointers. No matter what, you want to have like your eyes bulging out. And you also need to drop your jaw. And I recommend you go straight up with both of your arms and wave them side to side. And while you do so, be sure your head is rocking to the opposite side. That's how we panic, like this. And for some of you, especially if there's a strong current of dread in your panic, a deep bottomless hole of existential emptiness, or if you're recently experiencing neck pain, you may want to bring both of your hands to your face and mimic the scream by Edvard Munch. There's no such thing as too much participation in this exercise. So if more than one or all of the dynamics freak you out, let it move through you. You're among friends and allies here. Okay, so here are the options. Freak out for one or all of them because we have to face these feelings. Number one, authoritarian states are already developing social technologies for rather nefarious purposes. Freak out as you do. Number two, authoritarians throughout the world are using big tech social technologies, even those created in the US, that are far more powerful than the mass communications technologies used by history's worst villains. Very worthy of freaking out. Number three, the big tech social technologies are sowing division and chaos, tearing the fabric of democratic nations and weakening democracy itself. And four, these technologies are undermining the integrity, funding, and operation of the media, which is supposed to help us as a society deliberate through our problems. I'm freaking out about all of them, or at least I was when I wrote the talk, but the rest of the talk has calmed me down. But it's good. I want you to feel the fear because it is calling you to action. But remember that fear also biases your thinking. There's truth in your fear, but there's no use fighting or fleeing. There's no tiger in the room. So we're going to let it out, and we're going to move on to the next step of gaining a new perspective that might show us a path forward. To immediately soothe us all, let me first say that none of your careers are in immediate peril from technology. As long as there are militaries, there will be governments. And while some of the technologies on the horizon may help us all make more sense of the world and better ascertain the will of the people, none of them are going to immediately replace every government official, least of all those performing an executive or judicial functions. Second, let's recall that in an ideal world, governments actually fade into the background a bit. Ample evidence suggests that when people are well-resourced, crime is lower, and action problems easier to solve. So the vast majority of government officials already understand this. When economies and societies are running smoothly, the work of a government official is relatively easier and happier. Finally, what we are witnessing with the rise of social technologies is in no way a direct attack on government itself, but instead an evolution of broader society, a potentially fruitful evolution to a more reflexive society, one which understands itself and the cross-cutting social, economic, and political forces shaping the lives of individuals, families, organizations, and communities. This reflexive society, predicted by 20th century sociologists like Anthony Giddens, will in fact yield great dividends. As people better understand how we are creating and recreating our social realities every day and how we can work together to improve them. In the end, none of this has to render meaningless the lives of career public servants. There will even be roles for such dedicated professionals to shine in the tech-enabled society that is emerging. Okay, finally, we get to the happier part. How do we move from cacophony to the will of the people? At Alistair's suggestion, I entitled this talk Listening at Scale, from Cacophony to the Will of the People. But it's also, you know, retitled How I Learned to Stop Worrying and to Love Social Technology. First, let me define social technology. It's a slippery concept since practically all technology is social, certainly if it's shared in any way from one person to another. But just as the term big tech has evolved to refer to only a few companies' products, most of which are no larger than a bread box if they exist physically at all, I want to coin social technology as a term referring to software technologies that function based on significant social input and create social impacts at a very high scale. By this definition, most of the big tech companies provide some social technologies. Facebook, obviously, Google, probably, particularly its office and email software, Amazon's marketplace, they're probably not its cloud computing infrastructure. Netflix, maybe, though it provides too little interactivity among individuals to fit snugly in the category of social technology. And Craigslist, the online classified advertising platform, certainly is a social technology. Social technologies format the interactive behaviors of individuals, often at least partially mimicking the dynamics of previous forms of social interaction. And they do so at a scale that can reshape economic activity, accelerate pre-existing social processes like norm formation, which we've seen a lot of in the United States. And they can disrupt for good or ill the functioning of large-scale social institutions like government, media, and more. Here's the thing about social technologies. We've only just begun to see what they can do. Facebook, Twitter, TikTok, Instagram, all of these have been designed to make profit by attracting the attention and engagement of users who then click on advertisements. But they also all exploit human desires for connection, for self-expression and belonging. And there's so much more we can create with functionally similar many-to-many communications technologies that also support these and other worthy goals. To the humanitarians out there, in and out of government, it is our turn to take the foundational building blocks of social technologies and use them to design a happier, better functioning society. And in the San Francisco Bay in particular, this movement has already begun. Crucially, the answer to disruptive and harmful social technologies is not primarily to regulate them out of existence or break them apart. It's to outperform them in terms of those worthy social goals. That could mean replacing them over time in some cases, but it certainly means augmenting them to make them better. So I'll use the rest of the talk to demonstrate some directions that pro-social technologies are going and try to help you all envision yourselves as part of that movement. Let's start with an example of a pro-social technology that is incredibly relevant today and does not require slaying any dragons, only taming them a bit. Now, I think we're all pretty familiar with the problem of fake news and misinformation, and it's not a new problem, but with Facebook and Twitter and WhatsApp and all the other social technologies, we now essentially have 2 billion amateur publishers in the world that can share content, whether or not it's sensible content. We're going to show a video here really quickly, if we can.
All seen it happen. Someone posts a news story on social media and it seems outrageous. Everyone gets upset and shares it. Then days later, it turns out the story wasn't true. It was all spin and misleading information. But today there's hope. It's called Public Editor, and it's a nonpartisan review system that uncovers the biases and mistakes in news articles before they spread. It's run by volunteers like you, and here's how it works. Sarah is spending 10 minutes reading an article and breaking it into pieces. Then other citizen volunteers analyze those pieces so the entire article can be fully reviewed in less than 30 minutes. Public Editor automatically finds the agreement among independent volunteers and merges their best work together. Then it gives each article labels and a credibility score. The credibility score provides readers with a sense of an article's quality in a single glance.
and the labels show newsreaders where specific mistakes occur, so they never believe bogus information in the first place. Public Editor is simple and effective, and it's yours. It trains all of us to be a bit more careful when we're reading and a bit more thoughtful about what we share. So go ahead, give it a try, and help elevate the conversation.
I appreciate everyone suffering through my radio personality voice that I was coached to use for that video. Okay. Okay, great. So let me say a little bit about where we are with Public Editor. We have a system that's working. We've recently just finished a testbed experiment with the Global Engagement Center of the US State Department in partnership with the EU's disinformation team. And we found, looking at a bunch of Russian disinformation propaganda articles, we found that Public Editor was quite effective. Compared to EU experts, we found the same problems in 96% of the articles that we evaluated with Public Editor. And then we also found an additional mistakes, misinformation errors in 86% of the articles. So with trained volunteers, we were able to do this quite well. And our next step is to really scale up. You know, that demonstration was 250 articles. Our next step is to do, you know, several thousand articles. And the way that we do this to make sure that that the evaluations from Public Editor are reaching the public is we start with the 200 most shared articles per day. There's a service that lets us know which URLs are going viral. And we focus on those because we theorize that those are kind of the core, the foundation of the discourse in the United States or in whichever country. So we start with those articles, and then people can view the articles through browser extensions. We have one for Chrome, we're working on one for Firefox. We can also have volunteers in these debunking squads kind of go out onto social media and insert Public Editor articles in conversations that seem to be misinforming conversations. We're also in talks with some news aggregators, fact checkers, and news outlets right now about them being able to use Public Editor within their readership communities. So their community of readers and volunteers can work on articles that get published at that news source. And finally, what we want to do that we think will make the most impact is to work with Facebook and Twitter, which deliver a newsfeed to all of their users. We want to make sure that the users have an extension on those platforms so that they can filter out information that does not meet a particular credibility threshold. So if for all the articles that score less than an 80, for instance, a user can say, I don't want those articles in my newsfeed, and they can set that threshold for themselves. That sort of extension on Facebook or Twitter is entirely consistent with the United States Communications Decency Act, Section 230. There's some policy statements under notes 3, B, and C that essentially says it is a policy of the US government to encourage those interactive service providers like Facebook and Twitter to allow third parties like Public Editor to offer services to their users. So those are some of our next steps, and we're really excited about being able to tackle that problem at scale. But there are other ways too, and more organizations. A very, very good friend and colleague of mine, Jamie Joyce, has an organization called the Society Library, which is doing something a little bit different. Instead of just finding misinformation and calling that out for people so that they can learn to be more literate, the Society Library actually grabs ideas from around the web and starts to construct them. So they collect comprehensive sets of ideas from many points of view, and they carefully curate the ideas, the strongest form of those ideas, and they enter them along with their supporting evidence into a searchable online library of ideas. So this way people can view a thorough debate in a more thoughtful and careful way. We think this is really important because a lot of complex policy issues are probably not best discussed over a beer or at Thanksgiving dinner. They're simply too complex. There's too many issues within the issues. And like we see here, the topic of climate change has 274 different debates going on within it. So if we can make a place for all of that, We think it's going to be really helpful for a society to clarify what we're doing, what our problems are, what our priorities are, and how we can potentially move forward. So especially working together, public editor and the society library can go a long way to cooling these polarized debates and making sense of the ideas and evidence that are too often used for just for verbal combat instead of for getting to the bottom of what is real and what works. With these projects, society can begin to listen more carefully at scale. Learning to identify and avoid junk information and organize what is sensible into a format that clarifies the signals coming from the various points of view in a diverse society. And while both of these projects engage the public in structured creation of public discourse, there are even more ways to involve the public in conversations that help individuals to become more socially reflexive and better understand how they contribute to the construction of social reality through their beliefs, attitudes, and actions. One of those projects that we're developing at Goodly Labs is called the Goodly Mirror. And the way that it works is that there's an interface, and I have to give a shout out to Matt Salganik, who created this. The interface is called All of Our Ideas. And what it does is it allows people to input ideas, policy ideas, solutions, or any kind of idea. And then there's a huge set of these. It can be hundreds of different ideas. And using pairwise comparisons, it asks the users to decide, like, which is better, which idea is better, in this case, for creating a greener New York City. And by doing this at scale with a lot of people, you end up with a ranked list of which policy ideas are the highest priorities for that population. So we can use tools like this, for instance, to better understand the differences between human needs and wants, and then adjust our efforts accordingly. There are other clever polling methods as well that we can use to discover that some of the norms we follow because we believe they're important to most of us actually aren't important to most of us. By discovering these unpopular norms and educating ourselves about our true preferences, we may be able to move away from widespread hypocrisies. Beyond discovering our true preferences and priorities, we could also be deliberating through far better processes. Right now, most debate occurs through the media and the war by other means that best describes the adversarial politics of many representative democracies. But why, again, are we wedded to these fraught methods of public discussion? Goodly's Same Page project, in collaboration with MIT's Deliberatorium, led by Mark Klein, is reimagining many-to-many communication technologies and designing interfaces to structure deliberation and decision-making for small groups, families, organizations, universities, towns, and eventually even larger governments. I think anyone interested in democracy functioning at its best, while besting authoritarian challenges in and out of our borders, ought to be interested in this sort of technology. Not only will deliberation tools like SamePage help the communities who use them achieve better outcomes from cooperative effort, they can also train millions of people around the world in the arts of consensus and cooperation, indeed, in the values and processes of democracy itself. Of course, some issues cannot be understood and solved with structured debate alone because they're so complex. They require complex social scientific analysis. And here too, pro-social technologies stand to revolutionize longstanding practices. Many social situations and phenomena have been only partially understood by social scientists because their dynamics depend on too many factors that are too difficult to measure across thousands of comparable cases. Take the sociological subfield of social movements and protest policing, for example. Small end studies of one or two movements produce a lot of detailed descriptions, helping researchers understand what sorts of interactions could happen during political contention, but they can't clarify when those interactions matter under various circumstances. Large end studies, looking at thousands of events, can notice some patterns, but usually the data on each of those events is rather thin, maybe just a couple sentences that get boiled down to three or four variables. And such thin data reveal very little below the surface and also fail to tease out deeper patterns. Now, using the same annotation technology that's powering Public Editor, we can also power deeper, richer analyses of the many thousands of reports of protest events and police responses appearing in the news. And since the research includes trained volunteers and is shared with the public, soon everyone will have a common sense about how those events become violent or remain peaceful. And it's all backed up by the carefully collected and curated evidence and sophisticated data of scientific models. This is what we're doing with our DemoWatch project. And these projects, thankfully, are actually already being offered on SciStarter, which is a citizen science platform. So we're starting already to support new identities like citizen scientist, public editor, and demo watcher, identities that we that empower people with social technologies and give them a meaningful way to contribute. We can also turn these technologies onto our archives, to the Library of Congress, the Internet Archive, and learn a lot more about our national history, aspects of that history that currently lie hidden. Of course, with all the hype around AI these days, it must be noted that none of this will happen because of AI. Just talk to the best and brightest people at OpenAI who have built the most impressive AI to date, and they will tell you. AI can be trained to win Jeopardy, chess, and Go, and even write a short story, but it cannot do analysis and interpretation of complex social society like we can, especially with the new social research software I've shown you. Finally, the vision of running pro-social technologies cannot be complete without a discussion of emerging blockchain technologies and decentralized autonomous organizations in particular. Decentralization is not new, not in a relative sense. It's been part of human organization and governance for a long time. But it is something new under the sun in the same way that the printing press changed human history, even though people had already been writing for thousands of years. What makes DAOs so unique is that when properly constructed, they can grow and run ad infinitum without centralized human leadership. They do not depend primarily on personalities and political dynamics, but on a set of rules governing how people earn privileges in the organization, including decision-making power and even remuneration. Especially once these DAOs are equipped with online deliberation and governance technologies, they will be able to run without dedicated executives, managers, office space, or face-to-face meetings, even as extremely high-scale organizations. One of the pioneers in this space of DAOs is Douglas.io, which has already created, using decentralized peer-to-peer networking technology, functional clones of Facebook, Craigslist, Google News, and more. You can see here, this is its Google search engine running peer-to-peer. And here are some results from that search engine. Here's a Google News platform that's been created. There are tools for calendars and video sharing, a kind of a Craigslist clone, a community market, and even a Facebook clone. So we're coming a very long way very quickly. And this vision of the future I've laid out is motivating our work at Goodly Labs, but we're not alone. Many groups have formed up to raise awareness about the problems of current profit-driven social and AI technologies, like the Center for Humane Technology, New Public, the Social Science Research Council, and the Algorithmic Justice League. And there are also organizations like the Society Library, the Internet Archive, and Douglas that are already building infrastructure for pro-social technologies that will support a more sensible, democratic, and cooperative future. There are also countless software engineers around the world who would rather be working on solving these problems than maximizing clicks for advertising revenue. Starting today, what happened? I lost it. Did I lose my talk? Okay. Starting today, and for the next months, Goodly Labs will be inviting a consortium of research and technology partners to join a proposal for a new pro-social technology hub that will begin as soon as possible to work on infusing the best available social science knowledge into the design, prototyping, evaluation, development, and popularization of pro-social technologies. And we'll do this work in the open, educating the public about how society functions and how social science knowledge can be used to create pro-social technologies that help it function even better. So right now we are calling on democratic governments, one or many, to fund a research and development hub for the many social entrepreneurs, social scientists, and engineers committed to creating a better functioning, more reflexive society by designing pro-social technologies with social science in the loop. We hope this is an initiative that people who value democracy can support from across the political ideological spectrum. A technological union between those who cherish libertarian individual freedom from compulsion and those who would like to see individuals across society be able to more equitably share the risks and rewards of life and foster meaningful community. In just 5 years' time, for a fraction of the cost of a single military airplane, we can do this. Look forward to your help. Thank you.
I'm sorry, Nick, I didn't mean to cut you off there. So that's fantastic. And I love the work you're doing. As you know, we've talked about it before. I think that the stuff that you and Jamie and people like you, along with platforms like Polis, are the future of this stuff, because you know, we continue to use representative democracy. I made the joke this morning that the fastest horse in 1789 would take 24 hours to run from Houston to Washington, D.C., whereas a message can travel that distance in about 3 milliseconds. And yet we have 13 times the number of citizens per representative that we had back then. So, you know, that equation alone should say that something's got to change. And I love the way you're setting out to build it. I know some people may be heading over to the Q&A section and wanted to hear the end of this. Nick, we're going to make sure that we plug some of the things you're talking about in the newsletters and the wrap-up documents, and make sure that people have URLs for how to get to your content. But thank you so much. I love the talk. I found the Edward Munch scream emoji halfway through, and then you brought me back to hopefulness. So I really appreciate the emotional roller coaster this late in the day. And head on over to Q&A, and hopefully people there will have a chance to chat with you. Thank you so much for giving us this talk, and we'll follow up to make sure that we share some of those links with the audience worldwide as you're rolling this stuff out in the coming month.
Thank you, Alistair, and thank you, everyone.